all of this debt. Of course, we could have done it. You're quite right. We could have said no bank guarantee, banks collapse in 2008. That's a perfectly logical thing. We can discuss the costs or merits of that.
Right,
but the idea that we could simply say we will not pay a penny on this debt, we've been very lucky, Vincent. We've got a very, very large extension on the banking debt. In the case of 30 billion...
We're very unlucky to be paying anything at all on the banking debt.
We're paying virtually nothing on it at the moment. Should we ever pay anything?
We're extremely unlucky.
But it doesn't affect...
Don't say we're lucky to be paying so little on the banking debt.
Yes.
We're extremely unlucky to be paying anything on the banking debt.
That's a point of view.
But isn't it true?
But no, it's not.
What are we doing? It's not our debt.
My point, Vincent, is that right now, when we talk about the current state of the budget, the amount of the interest that we're paying on the banking debt is extremely small.
But it is more than the adjustment that is required in the fiscal on the fiscal situation.
Well, the idea that you could pay nothing on the banking debt
is a very extreme situation.
I don't think anybody would seriously suggest.
Richard, a $2 billion adjustment is puny, and we are a hugely rich country, and an adjustment of $2 billion, we could do it without noticing.
I don't agree, Vincent. I think the cumulative effect of tens of billions being taken out of the economy and out of the pockets of ordinary working people...
That's a different point now.
No, it isn't. $2 billion...
We're an extremely rich country.
$2 billion on top... I agree we're an extremely rich country. The problem is all the wealth is concentrated in the hands of a very few wealthy people at the top who don't pay enough tax. But $2 billion in further cuts or stealth charges or water charges or the planned health tax or further cuts in social welfare, or further cuts to health and education against a background where people are on their knees, where our public services are in massive crisis. We have a housing crisis, we have a medical card crisis, our hospitals are in pieces, we have special needs assistance being cut in the schools. Where are they going to take the cuts from that it isn't going to be an absolutely cruel and brutal imposition on vulnerable sectors of our society and ordinary working people who simply cannot take any more? And I disagree.
You could increase the universal social charge by a few percentage points for those earning 80,000 and more, which would get the $2 billion in, and no problem.
On the point about imposing higher taxes on the wealthy, I agree with you. But I do not agree that when we need a major investment stimulus in our economy, in areas like housing, in energy, in developing our natural resources, that we are letting... I mean, Donal said 10 or 11. I thought the figure was 8.3 this year in interest, and now he tells us 10 or 11. That's how much money is being sucked out of the economy. If we could even hold some of that back to invest in restarting economic growth and creating employment.
Richard, can I ask you, are you willing to say, I understand the logic, that we will not pay any interest on the loans that we got from the IMF or the EU? Is that what you're saying?
Yes, I am saying absolutely.
Can I just finish?
Can I just finish the point?
If that's what you're saying, fair enough.
If you want, you should be willing to accept that.
Absolutely,
and I want to say clearly, we had a 40% of GDP debt prior to the crash. After the crash, within a short space of time, that GDP had gone to 120% debt to GDP.
And you know why?
My view of why is because a crisis caused by bankers, speculators, politicians in Europe and in Ireland was then unloaded. The cost of that was unloaded on ordinary citizens. No. And I don't think any of that is a legitimate debt on the backs of ordinary people.
Quite frankly, Richard, I respect you greatly and I know where you're coming from with this, but I don't think this is analytically correct. The increase in Ireland's debt between 2007 and now is largely due to the budget deficits, which were hitting 20% in 2008 before we started the cutbacks. This is what is 80% of the increase in the debt. You are correct that the banking debt is part of it, but it is only
a relatively small part. The economic collapse came because of the activities of bankers, of the European Union, of the Irish political class, and the cost of that, either directly in terms of bank recapitalization or the economic collapse which led 300,000 people to lose their jobs, that was not the fault of the Irish people.
The collapse came because we had been living beyond our means. Now, you might disagree with that terms. In
ordinary
a completely
people had not
unsustainable
been.
Way.
The state may be living beyond its means because the state was inadequately funded. Don't say we're being living beyond our means. We weren't living beyond our means.
Let me explain what I mean. everybody who worked in the public service was receiving a level of salaries and benefits which are the highest in Europe. That was our decision. We took it, we were offered it, and we got it. People who were receiving social payments ended up with levels of social payments which were way beyond the average in Europe or elsewhere.
Because the cost of living was far higher.
I know. Well, actually, that's not necessarily so. But the point was that...
receiving social welfare payments higher than Europe. Could you live on social welfare payments?
No, that's not the point I'm
making. It is the point. It is the
point. No, it's not the point.
Could you live on social welfare payments?
That's not the
point
I'm making.
You are one of the people calling for readjustments in social welfare payments.
I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is...
It's okay for rich people like yourself to be calling for poor people to be made more miserable.
I think, Vincent, that's a personalisation which is not due justice to the issues involved. The issues involved are...
Exactly the point.
That the Irish budget in 2008... Before we ever got near banking, before we ever paid a red cent in interest to anybody, was running in 2008 at a level of 20% of GDP. That was because our revenues had been boosted artificially all the reasons we know, stamp duty and transaction
tax. Because the state was inadequately funded.
But did you want to increase stamp duties even more? Want to do that?
No, the state was inadequately funded. That's it. People keep on saying we were broke. We weren't broke. We're an incredibly rich country. We're one of the richest countries in the world.
In the case of the state,
we're about the 16th richest country in the world.
I disagree with you, Vincent. The level of expenditures in Ireland, and I don't think there are too many people who disagree with me on that, even Richard, had, in terms of the levels of pay and benefits and other matters... had reached a level which was completely unsustainable.
I've heard you make that point.
A point at which you have to think about marginal tax rates. It's not a black and white situation.
Okay, but people like you never talk about. There's a point at which it is just unfair to cut the living standards of people in the poorer sections of society. Nobody bothers talking about it.
I have no problem talking about it.
Does the Fiscal Council bother taking that into account?
I think the Fiscal Council or anyone else should be perfectly willing and able to talk about the incomes. Well, I mean, I'm talking about myself.
But does the Fiscal Council in any
other... The Fiscal Council is not under its mandate. Now, its mandate should be different. But it is not, and you know this, Richard, it is not under its mandate supposed to address political decisions which reflect social choices and political choices.
If I could get in, Donal.
We all have our individual views on this, by the way, in the Fiscal Council, and I have mine. But as a council, our mandate by law, which was approved by Parliament, is not to address questions about specific tax measures.
This is the problem.
Or expenditure measures.
Donal, this is the problem. The Troika don't think about these things. The Fiscal Council don't think about it. The Minister for Finance doesn't think about
it. But the public does.
Exactly. And the real human cost of these economic measures and the unfairness in how the costs of the economic crisis were loaded onto the poor, the most vulnerable, to working people, while the wealthy largely were insulated from the impact of that crisis. That is grossly unfair.
It is very corrosive
of society and democracy. And we saw the expression of anger against that in the recent elections and the Labour Party being virtually annihilated because it promised to protect the vulnerable and instead it adopted the sort of fiscal austerity balance sheet.
I'm not disagreeing with you. You want to come back in
on this.